Hey everyone, David C. Anderson here, coming at you from the Knife Center. Welcome to Knife AQ, episode 158, the series where I answer all your questions, whether they're sharp or dull. This week, amongst our questions, we're asking ourselves, what steel makes the sharpest knife? Let's get into it. Ta-da! All right, if you're new to this series, what we do is we look in the comments sections below these videos for the questions that you folks leave there and pull a few out to answer. So if you've got a question, you want to have a chance to have it answered in a future episode, just like the ones we're about to answer here, leave them in the comments section below. First question today comes from Jed Zanowski, 8645. I recently lost my whole knife collection to a house fire.
That's a burn.
I feel that without the jokiness. That's a bummer. For more reasons than just the knives, obviously. And I'm looking at the daunting task of restarting from scratch. I know I still want to collect knives, but every time I enter a store or go online, the excitement to get a new knife is gone. One, if you had to restart your whole collection on a very small budget, what knife would you pick up? And two, have you ever lost the love for collecting knives along your journey? And if so, how do you bring it back? Thanks. Edit. I guess I should say that my favorite knife before the accident was a custom bug out with S90V, and I really miss that knife, but anytime I go to replace it, it seems to cost too much, or maybe it doesn't give me the same feeling my old one did. For whatever reason, I can't seem to pull the trigger. Ooh, tough one, man. As to part two, if I've ever lost the love and how'd I get it back, not with knives specifically, but I'll say to get slightly philosophical for a moment, with anything you're looking at, let it grow. Let it be what it's going to be until it comes back naturally. Don't try to force it, and don't try to recreate either. If you're just pulling from the past and trying to make it, fit your new reality, that might be part of where the disconnect is coming in when you go to look at, say, for instance, that custom bug out. Maybe I'm reading too much into it. Maybe I'm projecting a little bit, who knows. But that would be my take on the second half of it. Don't try to force it. If the thrill isn't there, let it regrow. Don't chase it until it's ready. But in the meantime, you're gonna need a good knife, just because everybody needs a good knife, right? For something that might get you a similar amount and type of functionality that your custom bug out did, I have an option for you. My specific answer, if you check out the video Seth and I did at the end of last year on our top five knife purchases of the year, I actually kind of answered the first question there. And for me, it was the Kershaw Heist. If I had to restart on a low budget, knowing everything I know now, that would be it. But for you, for the custom bug out, and I don't have an S90V bug out here, but I have a M390 bug out with aluminum scales, what about something like the Kershaw Iridium? Here the two are next to each other, so you can kind of size compare it to the bug out you had. Slightly bigger, but not obnoxiously so. And it's $65. D2 tool steel blade, which is way more than adequate. Definitely holds an edge up there, better than anything else in this budget category, I would say. Aluminum handles, ball bearings in the pivot, awesome crossbar locking action with their Duralock, Kershaw calls it. That's gonna be an excellent knife for you. And I'd say, start with something like this. Get this, use it, let yourself appreciate it. Let it be a new beginning for yourself, perhaps. And the rest might come from there. Pour one out for you, my friend, I feel for you. Next question comes from Fritho 8410. Hi DCA. Can I ask if steel hardness is a limiting factor for how sharp a knife can get? Yes, you can ask, certainly. And you are, so good stuff. For example, given the same sharpening process with same angle of the edge and grind type, will a steel type hardened to RC6263 always be sharper than a steel type for which the maximum hardness is 58 to 59? Or can every steel type be sharpened to approximately the same degree, and then it's just a matter of how long the edge will hold its sharpness? Hope it makes sense. Fully aware of the multitude of factors determining the properties of the various great steels. Thanks for your content. Always enjoy the channel, sir. Thank you very much. I don't know about scientifically between the two different types you're talking about there. Certainly within the same steel, anything that's harder, as long as you've not, you know, surpassed the maximum achievable hardness of a given steel. That doesn't make sense the way I said it, but as long as you've not gone past the usable range of hardness, we'll put it that way. The harder steel will always be sharper than the softer version of that same steel. Will all steels that are at 61 hold an edge longer than all steels that are at 59? I don't know the answer to that. Someone more qualified than I would need to answer that. But I will say, I'm gonna come down to one part you said there, given the same sharpening process. I would say in that case, the softer steel, most likely, you know, apart from, you know, differences where there might be something getting wacky, the softer steel is going to be easier to sharpen, and given the same process, it's going to come out the other side sharper than the harder steel. You know, the sharpest knife in the world is the one that you can actually sharpen, which is why things like simple carbon steels seem to take such a super, super sharp edge. They may not hold it like S30V, but especially when you add it onto something with nice thin edge like a classic Opinel right here, it's always a good excuse to bring out a big one. What is this? The number 12. Always fun to see. Simple carbon steels, some simple stainlesses like your Sandvik 12C27, same thing. They are, or Swiss Army knife steel. It's a classic example as well. So easy to get steels and knives like that. Scalpel sharp or beyond. Scalpel sharp probably has an actual rating,
metric for that.
But you can probably get better. But anyway, those first few cuts especially, there's nothing that's ever gonna feel sharper than those softer, quote unquote, steels. Did you know air quotations had a sound effect?
They do now.
It's...
Might dub something else in there.
Oh no, please no. Oh boy. All right, next question comes from Alan Vasher. I was going to try to make some kitchen knives for friends and family. Awesome. Looking for steel suggestions, something stainless or low corrosion. I only have torches and a convection oven in my kitchen for heating, heat treating. Thank you. Given your equipment, there's no stainless I know of that you're going to be able to achieve, quite honestly. Speaking of 12C27, as far as I know, that's one of the easiest stainless steels to heat treat, but you are going to need something with temperature control. Such as a gas forge or something that can maintain temps over 1,000 degrees for a certain number of minutes. That's the soak time required for something like that. Not something you're going to be able to adequately control with the equipment you have on hand. So best bet, honestly, some of the simple carbon steels, 1084 especially, but 1075 should work pretty well. 5160 and 52-100, not too bad. 01's not too bad. But there's a reason 1084 is so often recommended for beginners and beginning heat treaters, because it can be done with the equipment you're talking about, and it can be done less precisely than it could be done and still get adequate results. Maybe not the best results, but you can still get functional results, and that's what's important. I will say stay away from 1095, however. It gets a little more finicky than 1075 or 1084, but here's a 1075 Condor knife blank, Condor Kephart knife blank, because we don't have any 1084 knife blanks to talk about. So I've done this before, and you do get a functionally hard, usable knife with this method. You may have to build yourself a quick DIY forge. There's tutorials out there on that. I used a coffee can and a mixture of sand and plaster of Paris for the refractory on the inside. I needed that with the torches I had to get a higher temperature than just the torches in midair. But here's what you want to do. With your torch, whether it's in the forge or whatever, you're going to want to get this steel hot enough so that it stops being magnetic. And the way to do that is just to have your magnet next to your forge or whatever, heat it up evenly. That's important. All the blade, not necessarily all the handle, but I usually like to try to get it back at least to where the first pin's gonna be. Even color as you're doing it. You don't want spots to be too hot. As soon as it becomes non-magnetic, stick it back in, get it that hot again, and maybe just a little bit past it, quench it really fast in oil, and then it's hardened, then you can temper it back in your oven, and there's timing recipes for temperature and time durations to achieve approximate target hardnesses. You can find all of that in a more thorough explanation than what I've given you just here, but that's the gist of it. Good luck. I hope you have a lot of fun making those knives. It's definitely a bug that will, you know, it's hard to get rid of. Ask me how I know. And then if you like it, you have fun, you want to invest in something like a forge, a gas forge, or something with temperature control, you can start heat treating other stuff like Sandvik 12C27. Hope that helps. Next question starts our lightning round for today. FG63-6, say I wanted to add a fork to my EDC. What would my options be? Does something like a Swiss Army knife fork exist? The fabled gentleman's hobo knife, perhaps? Sure, man, you want the MKM Malga 6. It got a fork right there. How about that? Bit of a cocktail fork, less of a, you know, shoveling forkfuls of food into your mouth type of thing. But for Swiss Army knife fork, baby, that's where it's at. You got a nice M390 blade on this version too. It comes in, what's the price on this? Like 115 or so. You can get magnet cut too, but those are a bit more expensive and the scales are all interchangeable on them too, which is another fun thing.
Work fine for happy hour.
For sure, hope that helps. Or you could just get a lightweight titanium camping fork. I have a titanium camping fork and spoon in my my backpack every day, so that's what I do. Anyway, next question, Bryson Davis YCZVGH. Hey DCA, I had a question. This may be a question from ignorance, but I didn't know besides Crucible and whoever makes the RPM9 steel, are there companies that make particle steels besides those? And if so, what are they? Thank you. Sure, you've got Carpenter for one. They're the most notable American counterpart or competitor to someone like Crucible. Although in the knife space, they're a much smaller player. They do a lot of other industrial stuff too. They make stuff like your CTS XHP, like on this Spyderco Sleesh Swayback right here. Awesome knife, very cool steel. You've also got Bowler or Bowler Udaholm or Vostalpine. I'm not even sure what they call themselves anymore, but we all know them as Bowler still. They make stuff like your M390 right here. They also make LMAX, some other stuff as well. And then you've got the company Damasteel that makes Damasteel, and they make RWL34 steel, like you see on this tie down, this Brian Tie custom flipper. So sweet. And that RWL34 also forms the basis or the building blocks of their Damascus product, their Damasteel, the Damasteel Damasteel. that's all. It's confusing because that's also the name of the company. And I'm pretty sure they forge their own steel. Now that I'm thinking about it, I don't think someone else is actually making the steel for them. I'm pretty sure they do. But if not, whoever makes that makes them. So hope that helps. I'm sure there's some others out there too. Those are the ones that immediately sprung to mind anyway. Next question, DecoBray23. Hey DCA, my brother lives in Hawaii and is really big into kayak fishing on the ocean and looking for a knife to carry to help dispatch fish after pulling them in the kayak. I'm not sure how big these fish are. So anyway, do you have any recommendations? And it would be a big bonus if it had a sheath and could be worn on the upper portion of the arm for easy access. This is definitely a case of Mora over really everything, which is what Mora stands for. My first inclination would be something like their floating knife with the cork handle, just because, hey, if you drop it, you might be able to retrieve it. The fly in the ointment here is, you know, dealing with fish guts and that sort of thing. It might be a little hard to keep the cork handle clean and sanitary. So something like the Companion in stainless steel blade is a classic choice. And if you lose it on the ocean, it's $17 right now for this version. I think they start at like $16 for the stainless steel options. So it's not worth crying about too much. The sheath on this is simple, injection molded with a J-style clip right there, but in conjunction with some armbands, it could absolutely be secured, inverted on this arm. That would be what I would suggest, because yeah, man, if you lose that, not a huge deal, and it should certainly do the job quite nicely. Sandvik 12C27 steel again. Ooh, we should have called that the title of this episode. Well, now we come to our final question of the day, which is, of course, our most serious question of the day, which comes from 2CL Forwards. Here's a most serious question for you. When I was new to the knife world, there was a lot of puzzling new jargon, but it was obvious to me what a dive knife must be. It's a tactical knife that you take to a sleazy bar. Obviously. We all know this jargon at this point, but I get it. I'm not here to make fun. The obsession with salt and corrosion on a dive knife was confusing. Unless it was about margaritas somehow. Could be. Are there other knives named for the places you would take them? This is a really good question because, as we all know, the true knife for diving is any flipper out there. I mean, it's again, pretty obvious for those of you new to the hobby. That is, you know, the best knife for diving is any flipper knife out there. Bonus points if it's like this Button Lock Knife Center exclusive right here. It has a name like Swordfish being underwater. Yeah. That's a cool option. 100 bucks with S35 VN steel. That's really cool. A couple others, a slip joint like this Buck Trapper. That'd be something you would take to the chiropractors for sure. And a bushcrafting knife. It's what you take into the backyard when it's time to trim the hedges, obviously. Folks in the comment section, you have any other suggestions for our most serious question asker here? Leave them down below. Because that is all that I've got time to talk to you about today. Let me know if you got any alternate answers in the comments, especially for this most serious question. I'm eager to hear what you folks can come up with. And again, if you got a question of your own to ask, drop it down in the comments and it might have a chance, or will have a chance, to be featured in a future episode. In the meantime, if you want to get your hands on any of these knives in front of me here, check out the links in the description to take you to KnifeCenter.com, where you can't forget about our long-running knife rewards program, because, you know, the least thing we can do if you're going to buy a knife from us today is give you some free money to spend on your next one. I'm David C. Anderson from the Knife Center, and that's Thomas behind the camera. We're signing off. See you next time.